we. Please don't say we in this context. I always make sure we fuck up somehow by clicking something I should not be clicking.
Next time we do it on my computer.
Oh, yeah.
You don't touch
anything. No, I should not be touching.
Ever.
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 No.
Ever.
I should not be allowed to touch technology.
Touch anything.
Especially not technology, because technology, I'm it's working now. Yeah, because technology and I, we're not the greatest of friends, and I am every technology that I touch dies somehow. It did break. You don't want to know why it broke.
At the same time as my soul break. Because
Ollie almost had a panic attack. We're good. We're back. And
let's chill out.
We're going to have a little bit chill out corner in my living room. We are back. Welcome back, guys.
Can we just take a nap?
I did a whoopsie. And but now here we are. Could we tilt the screen just a little?
Because what?
Because I'm too tall.
Are you going to sit like that?
No, yeah.
You're not.
I should be sitting like that. But I don't want to sit, because it's still cutting my head, even though I'm leaning forward.
Steve up.
A lot.
I'm going to turn off the live stream. Can we just be cleaning me?
I didn't do it on purpose. I didn't do it on purpose. That's just what happens.
Yeah, sure.
So we're going to give people a little chance to, ooh, look at that.
Yeah.
A chance to come back in because I did a whoopsie. I did a whoopsie with the technology. I'm just really real bad at it. Real bad at it. We also went into a rush mode because as we sat down to
don't say we.
No, but it was us because I said, look at the time. Suddenly we're in a hurry and you were like, oh, look at that. I was not prepared for the time to be that.
But
much.
I was in a rush.
I had
a full conversation with others too.
Yeah, I got into a rush mode.
Yeah.
I was running around trying to figure out what to wear. Because I had one thing on, and then I realized I was going to get too, I was cold right now, but I know I'm going to be hot later, because that's what happens to me at night. And so I put on, a light jumper, because I always wear this shirt.
Yeah.
And then Ollie was like, no, it's too light, so I had to change. And then I put on a black t-shirt.
And by light, we mean the color, like white.
Yeah, like a beige, soft beige. Yeah. And then, so I put this on and put a black t-shirt under it, and it looked really weird. And Ollie was like, why do you have to wear two shirts? You're going to get hot.
You're going to strip in the middle of this.
But I was cold now, so it was complicated. It got complicated. But here we are.
Gotta go make things so complicated.
Complicated. Did Ollie enjoy their time at the hairdresser? Yes. Can you look at this? This is some sort of, before, if anyone watched when we colored my hair, it was 90s Avril Lavigne. And now we're 60s, 70s hippie.
I feel I don't know, some really cool.
You look like a hippie from the 60s, and yeah. I love it. It's amazing.
I'm in love.
It's adorable.
I cut up a lot.
Yeah, and yeah, I think you had to. Your hair wanted
die.
You to. Yeah.
Wanted to die.
It was
tried
time.
To kill me. And so on.
It was time for the hair to go.
Yes, definitely.
For sure. For sure.
It was really nice. And the hairdresser is a girl that we've gone to for a lot of years.
Yeah.
So she's really nice.
She's the sweetest.
She had a lot of fun.
She's amazing. She helped.
She's not affordable, though. So I had to save up for 4 months to go.
Yeah, it's really expensive.
So I've spent all the money that I've had left at the end of the month. I've just been putting into another account,
a hairdresser account.
Yes,
yes. We gotta love the hair. What was that? I don't know, but there's witchy vibes. It is a little bit of a witchy vibe, right?
This is Lily's pregnant dress.
It is Lily's pregnant dress, but I think you wore it the other way around as Lily.
Yeah.
Cause reasons.
Yeah.
Can't stop touching.
It looks great.
Thank you.
It looks awesome. It looks really, really good.
I love it.
I'm so happy you finally got to see your hairdresser.
Yes, so good.
It was time.
It was time.
All right.
All right.
Are we, let's do it. Are we going? Hi.
Hi.
And welcome to our little chill out corner. It's Monday.
Yeah.
It's the start of the week, and we figured why not kick this week off in the right way with a little bit of a chill out. This will be re-uploaded when we're done. So if you can't stick around, that's fine. We can catch us later on YouTube.
Yeah.
And today, we're not going to read for you. That will be later. We will continue reading. And we will continue reading the same book. Not tonight. Tonight, we thought we would do what?
We are going to do the same thing that we did in our first pilot test thing.
Mm-hmm.
And we're gonna talk about some things that we enjoy slash are excited about slash
obsessing over
at the moment.
Yeah.
And we've picked two things each.
Yes.
And it's your time to start.
Am I gonna get started?
So what's your thing?
My
are you gonna talk about modulations for 45 minutes?
No. I'm not gonna talk about modulations this time. I'm gonna talk about something else that I realized just like hit me one day that I'm like, I need to talk about this because this is like a small obsession of mine all the side.
Oh.
So I got my phone with me for support. I wanna ease into it. I worked as a personal assistant.
Oh.
And after high school, it was probably like 2014,
yeah.
To an elderly woman, not elderly, honestly, she was like in her 60s. She had recently been diagnosed with a pretty aggressive form of Alzheimer's.
Mm.
So she needed help at home while her husband was away to work. And she had this this routine in her day where every day at 12 o'clock, she would watch Emmerdale.
Oh my God.
And for those of you who don't know, Emmerdale is a soap opera, a British soap opera.
Yeah. Oh, God.
And it airs 5 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
It's like 20 to 30 minute episodes. And they air it 5 days a week, every week of the year. It's insane. And I started watching that with her. And I watched it and I was like, what is this? What am I watching? Because it was so obvious that all of the plots and all of the relationships went back so far.
Yeah.
And I was like, I have no idea what's happening. Mm-hmm. This is crazy. And I felt like that every day that we watched until one day I realized I turned it on at home, even though I wasn't even at work.
Oh my God.
And I was like, oh no, oh no, I'm hooked now. So I want to talk about soap operas.
Okay.
And I want to talk about soap operas, and I kind of want to lean it in a little bit towards the last thing that I spoke about on our pilot episode.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm going to sort of explain what that means. But I'm going to talk about soap operas because I love a soap opera. And for those of you who don't know what a soap opera is, it's a televised show that's usually like a serial, like a long running, or it could be radio based. And they actually started off as radio based. And it's generally characterized by like melodrama and ensemble casts, like really big casts. And do you know where the name soap opera came from originally?
No. Someone was making soap and mm-hmm. they slipped on it because it made the floor slippery. Mm-hmm. And then they went, oh! And that was it. Right?
You got it. Yes. I'm so impressed.
I did musical theater.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. I'm a genius. My aunt also was a famous opera singer.
It was just second nature for you.
Yeah, in my blood.
The actual story about the main soap opera is actually not that, even though that's a very good version. It came from, in the radio, soap companies used to do like marketing and commercials for it. So they were like sponsored.
It wasn't as cool as mine.
It wasn't, no. But radio soap operas were usually sponsored by soap companies, and that's why they call it a soap opera. The longest running radio-based soap opera started in 1950.
Mm-hmm.
It's still going. And the longest running, it was called The Archers. It is called The Archers. And the longest running TV-based soap opera started in 1960 and is still ongoing. It's called Coronation Street. And I actually watched it, right? Like, you've heard Coronation Street.
I've never watched it.
Seen it on TV.
Yeah.
I watched it a little bit when I worked with this woman, because it came on directly after Emmerdale.
Oh, yeah.
So some days we just like continued watching it.
Yeah.
There are two sorts of soap operas.
Mm-hmm.
There are daytime and evening time.
Okay.
Daytime are like the ones like Emmerdale and Coronation Street. They're usually like shorter episodes and they're aired every day, basically. And then there are evening ones that are usually like one episode a week, and it's during the night.
Is it spicier? Because it's a nighttime.
I didn't look at the differences.
The spiciness
of the differences that hard. But they're longer episodes. So they're like 1 hour each week instead of like 20-minute episodes a day. And the main characteristics of that like, define the soap opera are, it's very much an emphasis on like family life.
Yeah.
A little bit like they want it to be like relatable.
Yeah.
It's family life. It's like personal relationships. It's like sexual dramas.
Yeah.
It's all that jazz. And at the same time, they occasionally try to cover like topical issues.
Yeah.
I know Emmerdale kind of often works with like mental health,
yeah,
and they want to talk about stuff like that,
yeah,
try to like ease it into it a little bit. And they're usually set in like familiar interiors and usually set on like one specific place.
Yeah.
So you focus on the group of people living in this particular place. As in Emmerdale, you're focusing on this village and the people who live there.
Yeah.
And we follow their like everyday life and everyday struggles and all that jazz. And the narrative, like most melodramas, is marked by a lot of coincidences and sort of missed meetings and sudden conversation and like last minute rescues. They used a term that is, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, but it's deus ex machina.
Mm-hmm.
And for those of you who don't know what that is, and I didn't before I read this, it's a term, it's a plot device whereby a seemingly unsolvable problem in a story is suddenly and abruptly resolved by an unexpected and unlikely occurrence.
Okay, yeah.
And that is very much like a basis
of soap
operas.
It's the most like
operas.
Relatable, unrelatable thing.
Right? And
it's
very...
like, I'm like, oh, I understand the family relationships, but I wouldn't kill my brother's wife and then have sex with her brother's child.
Exactly.
Because that's what it is. And then he stabs me in the back and marries my mother.
Yes.
That's
it's fascinating how soap operas can be so relatable and at the same time be so crazy. Yes. And so they work a lot with deus ex, I don't know if it's deus ex machina. It's Greek.
Yeah.
It's Greek. So they work a lot with this, and it's a very, as a viewer, it's, for me at least, I find these solutions to be very like unrewarding. Because it just works out because they need it to.
Yeah,
that's very much what that is. But what I want to talk like most about a little bit is sort of crucial elements of a story.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to go back to this later and sort of make a point that I'm very excited about. But I'm going to talk a little bit about like the crucial elements and sort of what makes them so addictive. Because that's what happened to me. I started watching it, and I'm a very like judgmental person when it comes to movies and series, and I'm very like,
But you also watch a lot of trash.
I do watch a lot of trash, and this is going to explain why why I watch so much trash. Mm-hmm. So it's a very like open-ended serial nature,
yeah,
to a narrative that spans over a lot of episodes.
Yeah.
I read a quote that said, each episode ends with a promise that the storyline is going to be continued in the next episode. And that's very much what it is, right?
Yeah.
Like, we're starting up a story, and then we're like, we don't really get to the end of it, so we're going to continue this episode.
Yeah.
Come watch us. To be continued in its essence.
Yeah.
And it also has multiple storylines sort of concurrently, like, run concurrently.
Yeah.
And sometimes they intersect and collide with each other, and sometimes they run like completely separate from
yeah.
each other. And sometimes they like connect to give more development to the story. So in one episode, the narrative thread can like in one episode, we might follow Ollie as you are getting married. And then we follow me, who is going to work. And then we have a third person who is, you're going to help me keep up with this.
I'm getting married.
I'm going to work.
I'm going to
start a new job. And then we have Hannah, let's say, who is going on a date.
Yeah.
And so in episode one, we might follow Ollie and me separately as we work towards our goal.
Yeah.
And in episode two, I'm not in it, but you and Hannah are
yeah.
like working simultaneously
yeah.
trying to reach your goal. And what this does is that it helps us not reach the final part of the plot
no.
of all the storylines
at
the
same
time.
Yeah.
But we try to like
so you're never
get,
like fully satisfied with
exactly,
it.
Exactly. Because when you get married, I still haven't had my first day
no.
at work yet. So we still
no.
want to find out
yeah.
what happens to me on my first day of
yeah.
work, even though we've sort of tied up your end of the storyline.
Yeah.
Which is so they work with a sort of rotation system, both when it comes to storylines
yeah.
and with characters, or with actors.
Yeah.
And also, generally, like we said, the episodes end on a cliffhanger. That's a very important one, that we end it on a cliffhanger. and the sort of the energy of a soap is very different depending on the culture. So
mm-hmm.
if it's from the US
yeah.
or from the UK or Australia, these are like the most common ones.
Yeah.
And
or like Korean soap operas.
I don't have any information about Korean
no.
soap operas. Sorry.
Honestly, I've seen a few episodes.
I mean,
Jesus Christ, God, it's the best thing ever.
I
and
can
like,
imagine.
And I like Spanish soap
yes,
operas
Spanish
with,
soap
with like the zoomings and like someone falls from a staircase.
Very dramatic.
And it, they fall for like 5 minutes because
yes.
it's everyone's reaction zoomed in.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, I love it. It's great.
It's
I
very
would love
bad.
To start. I'm going to learn Spanish
them.
Just because.
I just watch Hola. Them. It would be great. Just watch them and not understand anything. We should do that. We just watch it in Spanish and not understand a thing and try to translate
Please
like they
do
in do Friends.
It.
That looks so much fun when they do that in Friends. They just try to
Please
understand
do
it. Yeah, I'm all for it. But the main difference that I notice is like US.
Yeah.
They're usually very attractive, very
yeah.
seductive, wealthy and successful characters.
Mm.
And they're usually a little bit more to the serious nature. Like
yeah.
we have Days of Our Lives, we have like General Hospital. They're usually
very
serious in score.
Relatable.
And then we have the UK and Australians
yeah.
that try to focus more on like everyday life
mm-hmm.
and be a little bit more relatable. And they also generally have like a more of a comedic element
yeah.
to them.
Yeah.
It's a little bit more fun to watch. And this is where I want to tie in one of the things that I talked about in our pilot episode that we eventually cut because I got a little bit too excited. That's why I decided to start with it this time because I didn't want to get too excited. Is I removed my
coffee.
I have a love for the show Riverdale, and as I started going through what defines a soap opera, it landed in me more and more how much Riverdale has turned
yeah.
into a soap opera.
That's what it is.
At its core.
Yeah.
And like, if we just like go back to a few of the things that I said, how they like in the US, we want it to be like they're very attractive characters. They're very seductive.
What are you talking about? Nobody in that show is the most attractive person I've ever
seen. No one.
And I don't want to.
They also, they're 16, and they also have sex all the time. Like, all the time. All the time.
Some of us did that.
I mean, yeah, sure, but, like, it's very grown up in the way that it's filmed.
It's very gross.
It's in the way that it's filmed.
And it's just, like, their maturity about it is just,
yes,
like, that's nonsensical.
Yes, that's what I mean. They're very wealthy. Like, we have Veronica and this, like, insane wealth that's very unrelatable. completely unrelatable.
Even, like, the poor characters are super attractive, super stylish, smart,
super fit, and just clean. Yeah, it's crazy. We also have, like, just the Deus Ex Machina.
Yeah.
Like, the way things just solve themselves, and we don't really understand
why.
But, and I've also been, like, very annoyed by this, but now that I think of it as a soap opera, I'm like,
I love it.
It just makes sense. And all this, all the ensemble cast, like, that was one of the things that I talked about, the big ensemble cast. It's like,
Everyone gets, like, a chance at a story, like,
yes!
all the time.
And they run sort of, like, simultaneously, but not really.
No.
And they start a storyline, and then they drop it, and then pick it up a few episodes later.
Yeah.
The whole structure
is very
soap opera.
It's very addictive.
I also read a quote from one of the producers and directors of General Hospital, and she said, "If we want to blend an actor back into a show, there's always a way. You can generally find a way to twist and manipulate things. You rarely see a dead body, but hey, even if you do, he or she can always come back to play the evil identical twin." And this is also just very Riverdale at its core. It also says, like, soap opera storylines are weaved very intricate.
Yeah.
They're very complicated, and they're very, like, convoluted and confusing.
You could never, like, I couldn't, like, jump into Riverdale now, like, two seasons later and be like, yeah, I get it.
No, and if you
like
wanna,
you can do with, like, most, like, comedy shows or, like,
and one of the things that I've realized while I'm talking about soap operas, when I try to explain to you, like, what's happening right now, when you think it, you're like, this makes sense, and then you say it out loud and you realize nothing makes sense. And that's also, like, I don't think I could retell, I don't think I could tell you what's happening.
No, we're gonna watch
right now,
because
it's very confusing.
I don't have anything.
And there are always, like, characters who have affairs, and they meet mystery strangers and fall in love and commit adultery. And all these things are there to sort of keep the audience hooked.
Yeah.
There's also, like, a lot of crimes happening.
Yeah.
And people get away with it unless it sort of makes sense for the, like, unless it's a plot point that someone's going to jail.
Yeah.
Most of the time people just get away with it because it's sort of easier that way. That's also a very soap opera thing to do. And I love that. Because I love a good soap opera.
Yeah.
And so I'm obsessed with the fact that Netflix has been able to sort of revamp the original version of a soap opera and sort of just, like, popped it in there without people really understanding it, and just be like, yeah, you're gonna love a soap opera now, here you got one, and sort of hidden it in this, like, mystery teen drama vibe. And I love that. Like, I'm obsessed. It's so fun. Like, soap operas are,
like,
just,
it is,
like,
addictive. Like, every time I've, like, sat down to, like, if you have watched
Riverdale?
No, the other one.
Emmerdale.
Yeah.
Emmerdale.
When I, like, get here, I sit down and I'm like, what's this?
Why
is he angry at her? Why is she sneaking around? I don't want to know what's happening. Because my grandma used to watch it. So, like,
Emmerdale.
Yeah. And, like, even as a child, I was like, this is stupid.
Yeah, it is.
Like,
it's absolutely stupid.
She died when I was 15. Mm-hmm. So, and she didn't, like, so when I was, like, 6 or 7.
Yeah.
I remember someone's child got kidnapped for the second time.
Mm.
And I was like, you're stupid.
Yeah.
You're so dumb.
Yeah.
6-year-old Ollie was like, you're very dumb.
This is really weird storytelling. Yeah. And that's what's so awesome. Like, it's supposed to be like that, mm-hmm. in a sense. And I love it just for the fact that it's like, it's just dead brain for a while. And then, what I also really love is that, and I said this during the Riverdale rant, that occasionally they add in really cool prompts, sort of. And you're like, oh my God, this is so cool. And that gives me inspiration. Mm-hmm. And then I'm like, I'll do this better. It's fine. I'm just going to take this part of the story and then I'm going to make my own. And that's so fun. And it's really inspiring because it's just like it gives your brain a moment to just like die for a moment. And just like
you also feel like a very good like writer.
Oh, very good. And the best.
Yeah. Mm. You feel like you should have a Pulitzer Prize because what they're doing is
it
so
makes me
terrible.
Think that like if these people can do this for a living, then I should be able to as well.
But here's the thing, they have found like the key to like addictiveness, mm-hmm. which is like
that's
a hard toe,
yeah.
like line to toe, because it's one thing being an incredible writer and have like a one thing, like one book or something that, or one movie that gets like blown up.
Yeah.
But they have like found that they could do this show until the actors are like 45 and we would still watch it. Because
they have a recipe that works.
Yeah,
and they just repeat it.
They found the perfect recipe for our addiction.
Yeah. And it's
great
stuff. It's awesome.
Yeah.
I love it.
I love that.
Yeah. That was me.
That was so good.
That was my first one.
Okay.
Tell me about yours.
I took notes this time.
Ooh. More than just three rows. Like last time.
Yeah. Well, then the second one you're going to.
Oh my God. Okay.
Not be friends with me anymore. So this
is
our last one.
Oh no. Okay. The first one.
My first thing is the concept, the theory of the five love languages.
Whoa.
Which is a psychology theory by a guy who's called Dr. Gary Chapman. Ooh. And he published a book called The Five Love Languages in 1992. And he is a marriage counselor.
Mm.
So he has worked as a marriage counselor for a lot of years. Mm. And he wrote this book on his theory on how to make a marriage work. One of the theories he has to make marriage work that he worked with. Mm-hmm. And it's the five love languages. And it's basically, his theory is that you have one primary love language and one secondary love language. And everybody has this.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the way you communicate your affection and want to have your affection communicated to you. And I just love this.
We've talked about this
because this
times.
Makes everything make sense in my head. In my head, this is like the universal truth. For me, this is like some people are into like zodiac signs,
mm-hmm.
and I'm like, what's
your
love language?
This is your astrology.
What's your love language so that I don't fuck up?
Not what's your sign, what's your love language?
I don't give a shit about your sign. I don't know anything.
But we've
like,
talked about this a few times.
Yeah. We're going to talk about it.
Okay,
more.
Cool.
We're going to have a little
discussion. Okay.
Yeah. No, okay. So the five languages, I'm going to tell them. I'm going to tell them a little bit about them. And then... So the first one is words of affirmations. And this is when you want verbal affirmations. That's how you show love and that's how you want to receive love. And it's compliments, it's being told that your significant other loves you, it's noticing verbally when I got a haircut, you were like, oh, you got a haircut.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. When you wear a new shirt, when you have done the dishes, you say thank you,
mm-hmm.
stuff like that. So it's mm-hmm. a verbal, it's a verbal language, actual language. That's the first one.
Mm-hmm.
The second one is quality time. Which is you want to spend uninterrupted time one-on-one with another person. You want to have conversation without looking at the TV or without having your phone on or without doing anything else. You just want to like talk
one-on-one.
Yeah. And it can be like a 10-minute walk after work, like you walk together, or like it could be having breakfast together, et cetera.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. So set aside time for your partner. The next one is acts of services. And that's like if you're living together, it can be like doing the dishes, picking up your kids from school or work. Mm-hmm. This book is written, by the way, for married couple.
Yeah.
He also wrote one for children and one for single people.
Oh.
So like cool. He's written a lot of books and made a lot of cash. It could be cleaning up the apartment. You can go do grocery shopping. Mm-hmm. It could be like
taking out the trash.
Yeah, exactly. Or if you don't live together, it could be like, oh, can you pick up this thing on the way?
Yeah, whatever.
Mm-hmm. Or like if like we do, we like if one of us cooks food, the other one takes the dishes.
Yeah,
stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Then the fourth one is receiving gifts, and this is when your love language is receiving gift. It doesn't have to do with the price of the gift.
No.
It doesn't have to be expensive gifts.
It's
it could
the symbol
be
of the,
it's a thoughtful gift, like leaving a little post-it with like a cute message on the breakfast table, or like
or in your backpack. So you see it when you're at work.
Maybe nobody has ever done that.
Never happened.
It could be like buying flowers or just like leaving little like candies or whatever. It could be. No, it can also be expensive gifts, but that's like the main, your main love.
Mm-hmm.
And the last one is physical touch.
Mm. Yeah.
This is not about, it doesn't have to do with like sex and stuff. It's like holding hands, hugs, just like touching the other person randomly, like, or like hugging someone when they cook food or something like that. And it's just like, it communicates to the other person, like even when you're having a conversation, just like having their hand on you or like touching elbows or something.
Yeah.
That's how they receive love. So those are the five love languages.
Mm-hmm.
And, you can like, if you're in a relationship or if you're not, I think it's really cool to like, analyze which one is yours.
Yeah.
Because this is, for me, this has helped me so much with like all my relationships. I was talking to my mom earlier today about this, and I was like, and she had never heard of this.
Oh.
And she was like, what is this book?
Yeah.
This is so interesting. I was like, yeah, you're quality time 1000%.
Yeah.
And dad is not quality time.
No.
And they
clash a little sometimes
because I think dad's is acts of service because he likes when you like take care of stuff and mom like wants quality time one-on-one. We don't have our phones when we talk to mom. We like put them away, like stuff like that. She wants everyone together in the same room,
full attention.
Exactly. So I think this is, if you're in a relationship or in a friendship or whatever, his theory is that it can create huge conflict if you do not know your partner's love language. Because if, so my personal love language is physical touch.
Mm-hmm.
And if I was with a partner who never gave me physical touch, or if their love language was acts of service, I would not see that as they give them love. I would just be like, yeah, of course you're doing the dishes.
Yeah.
We live together.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's your job.
Yeah.
That's both of our jobs. You're doing the bare minimum. And for them, it's like, oh, but I do this because I love you.
Yeah.
And I'm like, but I need you to hold my hand when we're in public.
Yeah.
Those are like, that can create a lot of friction.
Mm.
And also, so his theory is kind of that you have a tank of energy, sort of.
Mm-hmm.
This fills up your tank when someone, your significant other, does this. So if your tanks run on empty for too long, that creates a lot of friction and frustration and just like feeling unloved, even though, and that can be like your partner showing you love, but just not in the way you want to receive it or the way you understand it.
Yeah.
So you can feel unloved in a relationship that, when you are very loved.
Yeah.
So that's stupid.
And it's a very easy thing to talk about.
Exactly. Like, but people don't know about
it.
And like, I think it's a very important thing to communicate about and just figure out what your partner's language is and ask them. And if they don't know, just like try to, his thing is like noticing like, how do they show you love?
Yeah.
Or like if they're, if they're like, oh, like talking about, oh, I really like flowers, or I really like, or if they're like looking at things on website, like shopping things, you can like notice it and be like, probably that's something. Or if they always like hold your hand, or if they're like telling you they love you or that they appreciate you and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then there's obviously like, especially with the words of affirmation, can turn very like toxic because it can turn into love bombing, which is when you too early in a relationship say I love you, just like you're the most important person, and that's a toxic behavior.
Yeah.
So
that's a red flag.
That's the biggest red flag of life. But like otherwise, it's like just like how to communicate with your partner. So if your tank runs on low too long, it can be really hard to start filling it up again because you have like it has just like been emptied out for too long. So it takes a lot of time to fill up until you actually feel love, even though they're speaking your language to you. So that's the thing. And I think that's like a lot of people have talked about during the pandemic being touch starved.
Yeah.
And that's a thing that this is like, if your love language is touch and you haven't like hugged or held anybody or have any human physical touch, like your tank is running so low.
Yeah.
So when you get it, you get high in your brain, get so much endorphins and stuff like that you get such a high. And I think that's a lot of people. So I have like looked into what this means during the pandemic a little bit.
Ooh.
And like people, if they start to date someone, they instantly move in with each other because they get so high, because they get like the words of affirmation or the acts of service because they have been so starved of it, of their love language. So that's why people get like, make like crazy decisions right now during the pandemic, because no one has ever like in our lifetime gone through anything like this.
No.
So yeah,
that's really
very important. And what's your love language?
Oh, we've talked about this. And like, as you started going through them, I was like, wait, which one's mine? Which one's mine? Which one's mine? I think...
I love that we haven't had this conversation.
But we have. I feel like we have.
Yeah.
But
not like this. I didn't know this much about it.
No, we definitely haven't.
I like
read
a bit of the book.
Oh, wow, really?
Yeah.
I think, oh gosh, I think I'm...
Because you can have one that you want to be at you, and then you can have another one that you give.
Mm.
So I have, like, I want to receive touch.
Yeah.
And I do, like, give touch also, but I also really, the thing that gives me also, like, words of affirmation, I do that a lot.
Yeah. I think the one I give is like, I get a high from giving gifts.
Yeah.
Like that's one, that's a big thing.
Definitely.
I love doing that. I want to say acts of service.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, you'd agree?
Yeah.
I think that's probably...
Like people taking care of your dog.
Yeah.
Or like doing the dishes. Or
yeah, like just like helping me out in everyday life is like really, really, really important. Like not important, but it's very valuable.
Yeah.
Really, really valuable to me.
Yeah.
I think that's probably.
Yeah. That's good. And yay! Then you know what you should do then? Start asking for it.
I know. That's also...
No, but that's like,
yeah.
That's hard because your partner, like if you don't, if like you have a hard time asking people for help. And that's your love language. So that means that you're starved of it. You're starving yourself if you don't ask people for it. And then it's harder for you to receive it when you get it.
Oh, wow.
Welcome to therapy.
Oh, wow. That's crazy.
Yeah. Right?
Oh, my God. The revelation.
Yeah. And that makes it like whenever you do receive it, it makes you hard for you to receive it because your tank is so empty that it like clings onto it and like, okay, I'm never going to let this go because I can't do it again because it's probably going to run on low again. You're having an existential
crisis. Yeah, a little bit. A little bit. Because I'm always like, I can't ask again because I just asked and now I can't ask again because...
That makes you afraid of your love language.
Oh my God, that's crazy.
I'm a licensed therapist now.
Yeah. Holy crap. The revelations. Yeah. Oh my God. I need to work more on this, clearly. Yeah. I've gotten a little bit better.
Yeah.
But it's for sure still like a...
I've also gotten better because physical touch is like one of the hard ones because some people don't enjoy physical touch. And like when I was younger, when I was a teenager, I was like, everyone loves hugs. Mm-hmm. So I love like hugged everyone and like snuggled up to everyone. And I'm 1,000% sure that I made a lot of people uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. And it also came across as me like wanting something more, which was also often not the case. Yeah. I'm just a very snuggly person.
Yeah.
And I'm like snuggly pretty instantly with people. Like I understand personal space, but like I can like hug someone the first time I meet them.
Your first time
you meet them. If I have a good feeling of them.
Yeah.
And that's also like, if I do that, that means that I like you.
Exactly.
Like I have like gotten a good feeling, a good vibe from you.
Yeah.
Because I'm speaking my love language to
you. And that's always been like a sort of a tricky thing for us because I don't mind it.
No.
But I forget that it's such a big deal.
Yeah.
So I don't even think about it. Like I just go on, and then I'm like, "Oh right, you want me to hug you? Okay, I'll do that." And then I know because our problem is that if I don't give it to you naturally, you feel
I feel anxious
about asking about it.
Yeah, I think you're angry.
Yeah, and I'm really not. It's just I just don't go there in my head. So let's just fill out the tank a little bit.
Let's
just fill this up a little bit. Because I realized when you started talking about it, I realized we didn't even hug when we met today. And that's a little bit crazy. So let's just fill up the tank a little.
Yeah, but and that's a thing. Because if we do that, like when we say hello or goodbye and we don't like hug or like give each other a kiss, I'm like, oh, she's angry.
Yeah, and it's just not the case.
I know that.
I know that's what your brain does.
Yeah.
And that's how that has always been a problem for us. Because I'm like, blah, 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 and I forget.
Or just like when we're walking with the dogs, if you take my hand, I'm like, full tech instantly.
Energy. That,
like for me, it's, for me, like it's very instant. And that's with everyone. That's not just with you. Like,
no.
With my little brother and I had like take long walks and listen to Harry Potter, and it's so nice. But we like hold arms or like hold hands when we do it because both of our language is physical touch.
Yeah.
So that's like great.
It's perfect
match. And he's my brother, and I'm like, I'm high from this. This is great. Because it's just I don't know, physical touch works for me very good.
Yeah.
So that was my thing.
That's beautiful. I love that.
Yeah,
that was really, really great.
I really love this. This is a great book. It's like, it's very heteronormative.
Oh, okay.
And it's
just,
but like the theory of it is really good. So you can like watch, if you don't want to read it, you can watch. There's a lot of cute videos on YouTube where they like explain it with like cute little cartoons
animations
and stuff like that.
Yeah. Oh,
that's
so
there's
really
a lot. So I watched like 25 of those.
That's
in preparation,
awesome.
And then I wrote like listened to like the first chapters of the book, and then I read some Wikipedia articles. Like,
wow, you really did your research for this one.
Oh, the next one.
Okay,
you're gonna laugh.
Can I take a quick bathroom break before I go into my second
one? Can. Then I can watch the 10 million comments that is coming in. Oh, hello, Moon Girl. I saw your thing, but then Eli started talking, so I. The Jughead thing. You guys. I'm gonna die and be gone and dead forever. Eli has just made the Jughead t-shirt. She has the hat. I'm not gonna be a normal human ever again after this. I'm so happy. There's like quizzes online that you can take. You can just like type in like the 5 love languages quiz, and then you can see which one is yours. And like I said, you have one sort of primary and then one secondary, and it's really good.
What are you doing? Oh,
cutie.
This next one is a really, I'm a little bit nervous about it because it's so random, but
I got two comments, but that's...
We can just scan through. I can tune this while you scan it.
Sure. Mostly cut touch with giving, but a little bit more words of affirmation with receiving. Yeah, and you can do that. Like, the thing is, like, also, as me as an anxious person, I love all of these a lot. Because all of them are attention.
Yes.
But I know that, like, physical, like, none of them give me, like, a high, like, physical touch. And, like, but I really do, I need words of affirmation, too, because that calms my anxiety. And that's, like, a whole lot. That's not my love language, but that just, like, calms my brain. So it's, like, you have to, like, see which one is your primary, apart from your anxiety. Like, take everything away. Just what gives you, like, what makes you feel the most loved. The clash is hard. My sister shows love by giving gifts, and I by quality time. But then you can give the gift of quality time. You can be a little sibling date.
Yeah.
That's
always really appreciated.
Because quality time is like, it can literally be like, we always try to have breakfast with each other, or we take a walk after work, or we just like have 10 minutes before bed, we talk or something like that.
So it's really,
it doesn't have to be like, we're going to spend 24 hours together at all time, uninterrupted.
No.
It's just like, because these love languages is about like constantly filling up the tank for your significant other and like with like small things. Mm. Like literally me, I'm like, I remember when I had my job, I think I told you about this because I was so touch-starved. So like a colleague of mine was like, can you do this for me? And I was like, please don't stop touching me.
Yeah.
They touched my shoulder and I was like, oh, please stop. I love you now. And that was very problematic.
Yeah.
But like, I was like, I could feel like the chemicals in my brain just.
The endorphins just kicking in. Yeah.
So like, it doesn't have to be much. It definitely doesn't have to be, like I said, a sexual thing.
No.
And that's so like, even if you're like, asexual or whatever, this can still be your love language.
Yeah.
So I think that's what makes it super interesting.
Yeah.
That it could be like, even if you're like not into relationships or sexual relationships, you can still have any of these languages. Because like I said, I have it with my brother and I have it with my mom and with my friends. I know what their love language is, or I try to like see what it is, and then I try to like accommodate it because it just makes your relationship stronger. And I want my friends and family to feel loved, and I want to like receive love as well. So, that's really nice.
Those are really great.
Yeah,
that was really great.
Okay,
do your thing. So the last time we did a pilot, I played some music and it didn't really work out because YouTube was like, no. So I have a band that I want to talk about.
Ooh.
But instead of playing their music, because the music is a very big part of why I want to talk about them, so I figured I would play some songs instead, because I feel like that will be good. Like, that will work.
I will love it. If YouTube takes it, I will go there.
I don't think they will.
I will make
it. I've done a lot of covers on YouTube, so we should be fine.
I will commit.
I'm going to play three songs, but I'm going to play one, and then I want to see if you've heard it. And then I'm going to talk about the band, and then I'm going to play two more. Don't cry.
I'm going to not try at all.
And not
I have
try
waterproof mascara.
So the first song, because I have two songs that I had heard, because this is a very old band from the early 70s, late 60s, early 70s.
Perfect.
So, yes, exactly. So when I played, so the story behind it. Let's go with the story behind it. My dad is a big music fan, always has been. And I think if he had had a different childhood, he would definitely have been like the kind of guy who was in a band.
He and my dad would have been in a band,
yeah,
for sure.
But life had other important things for my dad to do. So instead he had like music as a sort of a hobby on the side.
Yeah.
He played the guitar and he was the one who got me to start playing the guitar. And since he couldn't like play the music himself, he very early started collecting vinyl records. My dad is born in the 50s, so like when he grew up in the 60s, 70s, 80s, this was the main way to listen to music. So he started collecting, and he got this massive collection of vinyl records.
Yeah.
And so now when he and my mother were moving out of their current apartment and into a new one, he had to get rid of them because he had an entire
shelf.
It was like an entire bookshelf, bookcase, oh, basically, of vinyl records.
And why do we have the same dad and the same brother?
I don't know. Because we're the same person.
Our mothers are very different, though.
Couldn't be more different. So we had all these vinyl records and nowhere to play them because he didn't even know record player. And so he turned to me and he was like, do you want them? And I had a record player and I had already started collecting a few records, and I was like, yeah, give me.
Mm-hmm.
And it started off as him being like, oh, go check out what you want, take what you want. And I started going through them, and I found some Beatles and some Pink Floyd and all this stuff. And then my dad sort of snuck in and started handing me sort of his favorite albums. So he was like, oh, you need to have this one. Oh, this, you're gonna love this. And sort of meanwhile, as he did this, he started playing the music on Spotify. So he was like, oh, this band is this song.
Yeah.
I think you're really gonna like this. Yeah. And then he gave me the records. And I think a lot of the records he gave me was just like memorabilia that he didn't want to give to anyone else because he knows I'm gonna keep it. And this was one of the bands that he hinted at me, and he gave me a lot of their albums, and he played a song. I couldn't even remember what song, but I was like, this is cool. I'll like this probably. And then 2 weeks ago, I grabbed one of their vinyls and put it on. And I have not been listening to anything else since. I'm obsessed. And I still don't know how to pronounce their name, because when I first read it, I said Bread. Uh-huh. And my dad said, no, it's Breed. And I still don't know. I've been trying. But it's spelled like Bread. It's B-R-E-A-D. Breed should be two E's. This is how you spell Bread. But I trust my dad. Even though he does not know English very well. I try to Google how to pronounce it, but I can't get anything. And when I clicked on videos on YouTube, they're just too old for anyone to introduce them. Mm. Right? So, but my dad said Breed, and someone tells me otherwise, I'll just call it.
You'll get until proven.
So I started listening to this album that I found that's called Baby, I'ma Want You. And it is an album they released in 1972. And this was one of the songs that I heard and I went, I know this song. And I want to see if you get that feeling as well, or if it's just me. I'm going to keep... I've been playing these so much because I wanted to get sort of good at them until this live, because I can't redo it. Okay, let's do it. Shelter me from harm, keep me warm, keep me warm. You gave my life to me, set me free, set me free. Finest years I ever knew were all the years I had with you, and I would give anything I own. Give you my life, my heart, my home. I would give anything I own. Just to have you back again. You taught me how to love, what it's all, watching you. Nobody else would ever know the part of you I can't let go. I would give anything I own, give up my life, my heart, my home. I would give everything I own just to have you back again. Is there someone you know, you're loving them so, but taking them all for granted? You may lose them one day, someone takes them away, and they don't hear the words you long to say. I would give anything I own, give up my life, my heart, my home. I will give everything I own just to have you back again, just to touch you once again.
It's such a beautiful song.
You recognized it.
Yeah.
Right?
I think you my dad. I think definitely my dad has this.
Right? This is for sure one of their most like popular albums. And this was written by the main artist, David Gates. He wrote this for his dad. I know.
Kill me now, please.
I think his dad passed and he wrote this for his dad. So I want to talk a little bit about Breed Bread, whatever they're called. And I'm going to play two more songs. I'm going to play another one that I had heard, and then I'm going to play my current favorite one. But first, we're going to talk a little bit about Breed Bread. They were a soft rock band from LA originally. They were fronted by David Gates, who wrote a big amount of their music. He was the lead singer, but he also played, the bass, the guitar, the keyboard, violin, viola, and percussions.
Yeah, no problem. Like, you know, everybody.
This is going to continue with every member of this band. The other member was Jimmy Griffin. He and David sort of started it off together. Jimmy Griffin did vocals, guitar, keyboard, and percussions. They had Rob Royer, who played bass, guitar, flute, keyboard, percussions, recorder, and did backing vocals. And then they had like a number of drummers for their like their first two albums. They had like the higher
end
drummers.
Because all the percussionists couldn't do it?
No, they could not. So they had Mike Botts was the first one who like became their permanent drummer.
Yeah.
In when he joined in 69, and then he got replaced by Larry Kechtel. I think it's German. Let's say Kechtel because that's easier.
Laura,
he joined in.
Is it German?
Is it Kechtel? Let's say no. It's Kechtel. Kechtel. Kechtel.
I don't think that's German, right?
I don't know. But he joined in 71. So the band was created by David Gates and Jimmy Griffin, who in 1968, this was the year my mom was born.
Oh my God.
How crazy is it that I still have this vinyl and can play it? It's crazy. In 68, when they were sort of introduced by their mutual record label. So their record label was like, you guys should probably work together. You're going to make some good stuff. And they hit the Billboard 200 like a bunch of times with singles and records. All of the 11 singles of Breed Bread. Between 1970 and 1973 were written by David Gates. And this sort of caused a little bit of friction.
I can only hear David Yates when you say it, and it's so annoying.
David
Yates.
It's created a little bit of friction between David and Jeff, mm-hmm. because Jeff also wrote a lot of music for the band, but he felt like most of his songs sort of ended up on the B side of the vinyl, while David's ended up on the A side. And for the youngsters out there who don't know what a vinyl is or how it works, the vinyl has two sides to it, and generally what happened was like the songs they felt would
the hits
were on the A side, and then you flip the record over and put it down and you got the B side, and those were like the lesser great songs. And so Griffin felt like a lot of his songs sort of ended up on the B album, and it created enough friction for them to actually split in 73. So they played from 68 to 73. It wasn't really that long.
No.
And they split in the summer, and in March the same year, so before they split, they released sort of a best of album, like a compilation album, that was a huge success. Oh. It landed them on like number 2 on the Billboard 200s, and they chilled out there for 2 years. Yeah. And it went well. For 2 years, they chilled on the Billboard.
Imagine a song doing that now.
And this wasn't even
impossible.
A song. This was an entire album that just vibed on the Billboards for 2 years. It's absolutely
crazy. That's so
crazy.
Cool.
They have amazing music. It's crazy.
Oh my God.
Fun fact, the guy, which I think it was Rob Royer, who played like bass and flute and guitar, he also joined Simon and Garfunkel to write Bridge Over Troubled Water. So like, these were great musicians, right? Like, these kinds of musicians. That's what that's why I love like old music.
Yeah.
Because like, you don't make musicians like this anymore, where
no.
they all play like 14 instruments each.
Yeah.
I watched, they have a live show on YouTube from like the early 70s, when they're traveling and they are in England.
Mm-hmm.
For a show, an hour show, and like during this show, David Yates, who's the front man, he like goes between playing the bass in a song, and then he changes, and then he plays the acoustic guitar in a song,
God.
And then he goes to the piano, plays the piano on a song, and they all sort of do this. They're like, no, I'm gonna play like the whatever this is called, I don't know,
an accordion.
Yeah, in one song, one of the guys is like, I'm gonna play a banjo in this song. It's amazing to watch how musically talented these people were. It's absolutely amazing. And they later reunited in 77. So a few years passed when they weren't playing together, and they reunited in 77 because their record label was like, you should write more music. You should get over your differences and write more music. And they did.
We're going to put some of your songs on.
Just going to.
Whatever.
Yeah. And they did. They got back together, and they did a new album, and it went really well. And they started touring again. And then they did like a world tour, I think, everywhere in the world.
They did a world tour of the world.
And then sort of when they were about to start the third leg of the, they had a little break, and then they were going to start the third leg of the tour. And this is from the Wikipedia article. Apparently, David Yates failed to invite Griffin to this tour. And so they split again because that was rude. So that caused some friction that led them to split again.
Are you going
to
go, hey, dude, are you going to go on us with the tour? Like, what seat do you want on the bus? What tour?
I didn't know the tour. Did David not tell you? Uncomfortable. Yeah, so they split again because David was a bitch. So they all had like their solo careers. On the side, David did some stuff and Griffin did some stuff. And then they reunited one last time in 96. So this is, they split again in, what was it, like 77. And they reunited in 96. So that was like 20 years later. They did a reunion tour. of the US, the UK, Asia, Europe,
Jesus Christ, you name it.
They did a major, 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 and it was sort of their 25th anniversary thing. So they, South Africa, all of it.
Oh my God.
And then the tour was extended from 96 to 97, which was the last time they ever played together. Mm. And they were actually inducted into the Vocal Group Hall of Fame in 2006, which is really, it's I was going to say klockrent, because it's just, it's so spot on, because they're described as a soft rock band, but when you listen to their music, it's very influenced by the Beatles and sort of the Beach Boys. Yeah. It has this sort of boy band vibe to it, the way a boy band was in the 60s, 70s. And they work beautifully with harmonies and melodies. Like the way David Gates sings is just, it's breathtaking. And he has this like falsetto voice that he can go into that is like unlike anything else. And they had a really interesting way of, I think the reason why they're not sort of categorized as a pop group is because they played a lot with genres, but they also wrote lyrics in a very interesting way. It wasn't the classic like verse chorus thing, which you're gonna see in the next song that I wrote. It was very like poetic almost in the way that they wrote it. They didn't really care for choruses and verses. They just sort of wrote a lyric that was really beautiful and then sort of put music to it.
Cool.
Which is really, really cool. And unfortunately both Griffin and Botts passed away of cancer at the age of 61. Mm. And
that's nothing.
No, it's really nothing. It's so sad. And Knechtel, or whatever his name was, Knechtel, died of a heart attack at age 69, leaving David Gates and Rob Royer as the only living members of the band to this day. David Gates is 80 years old today, and he sort of settled down into retirement. And Royer continued for a while to write music for other people. He's 78 today, and I think he's sort of into retirement as well. And it's, they're just, the music is just, the melodies. I'm a sucker for good melodies, and I rarely really care about the lyrics, but
we're
this band.
Complete opposites.
Yes, so different. But this band sort of manages to do both really well. And I have like songs that I'm like, oh, I want to listen to the one with that lyric. Like the one that, about
that's
Aubrey.
How I listen to all
songs. They have a song about a girl named Aubrey that is just beautiful, and I'm like, I want to listen to Aubrey because it was so cool with the lyrics. It's
that.
A beautiful, beautiful band. So I want to play another song that is actually, all these songs are from the same album. No, not the last one. The first two are from the same album, and it's from the album called Baby I'ma Want You.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the song that
the
album is named after. It's called Baby I'ma Want You. And this was also one of those songs where I was like, I've heard this.
Okay.
And it's also one of those songs that has a really interesting structure to it. It's not like verse, chorus. It's very, here's some cool lyric.
Okay.
Let's enjoy, sort of. So here we go. Baby, I'm want you. Baby, I'm need you. You're the only one I care enough to hurt about. Maybe I'm crazy, but I just can't live without your love and affection. Giving me direction, like a guiding light to help me through the darkest hour. Lately I'm praying that you'll always be staying beside me. Used to be my life was just emotions passing by, feeling all the while and never really knowing why. Mm-hmm.
baby, I'm praying that you'll always be staying beside me. Used to be my life was just emotions passing by. Then you came along and made me laugh and made me cry. You taught me why. Baby, I'm gonna want you. Baby, I'm gonna need you. Oh, it took so long to find you, baby. Baby, I'm gonna need you.
And then, like most great songs at this age, it just fades.
Like, the build of this song is so interesting.
Because it's just like, it's verse, verse, bridge, bridge, done. Like, there's.
It's so cool. Have you heard that one?
No.
It's so cool. When I heard it, I was like,
here's the problem.
This.
When you sing me songs and you're like, you have to listen to song, I'm like, no,
I can't
want
hear
to.
I just want to hear this version over and over again.
And this is just really cool. It has like a little solo to it that I'm not gonna play. Can't remember where I've heard these songs. Exactly. That's how I felt. I
feel like it's like a
song
from a movie or something.
Right?
Like that. Yeah.
And probably it is. I know David Gates actually wrote some movie music, but like it was in the 70s, like 60s,
yeah.
70s, so it's probably very, very old. Surprised he didn't. Ask my dad if he knew them. Oh, he didn't. Oh, cool. It's great. So this is the last one that I'm gonna play. This is my favorite right now.
Okay.
It's called Diary. It's not one of their most famous songs. Like the first two that I played is on their top five on Spotify.
Mm.
This one I sort of stumbled across when I just started like shuffling all their albums. And I heard it on their live concert on YouTube that I listened to because I wanted to hear how they pronounce their band, but they never said it. So I was like,
you're like, we are bad that you bring infected.
Because the concert was like theirs.
Mm.
So he was just like, hey, cool, thanks for coming. I'm gonna play some music for you.
Of course.
Yeah. So there was like, hey, we're bread, breed. No, none of that.
We're
I
dead.
It, but... so this is called Diary. This song I mainly love for the lyrics. So I'm gonna try to pronounce it as like articulate it as much as I can. Because it's so beautiful.
Never heard of it.
No, right? I found a diary underneath the tree and started reading about me. The words she'd written took me by surprise. You'd never read them in her eyes. She said that she had found the love she'd waited for. Wouldn't you know it? She wouldn't show it. Then she confronted with the writing there. Simply pretended not to care. I passed it off as just in keeping with her total disconcerting air. And though she tried to hide the love that she denied, wouldn't you know it? She wouldn't show. As I go through my life, I will give to her, my wife, all those sweet things she can find. I found a guy. cherry underneath the tree and started reading about me. The words began to stick, the tears to fall. Her meaning now was clear to see. The love she'd waited for was someone else, not me. Wouldn't you know it? She wouldn't show it. And as I go through my life, I will wish for her his wife. All those sweet things she can find, all those sweet things they can find. Right? It's so beautiful. It's so gorgeous. And this is just like, this is just like three out of their like million songs. I highly recommend.
That was gorgeous.
It's so beautiful. And yeah, this band is, like I said, I've been listening to nothing else. And I chose like three of their more chill songs, but they work a lot with like very beautiful chords and very like nice guitar picking. And then like occasionally they throw in like a really random country song or whatever. It's a great band. It's the music is amazing. So definitely if you want to listen to more of it, I recommend listening to Breed Bread.
B-R-E-A-D.
Yes. And Baby I'm a Want You is my favorite album, but they're all good. Really, really
so
great.
Cool. That's a great one.
That was my last one.
That was so good. Yay. Okay, now we're not going to be friends anymore.
Oh my God, I'm scared now. What is this
last
one?
We're going to be friends.
Okay.
You're just going to think that I'm
crazy?
Yeah.
After talking about soap operas?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm going to... Okay.
Finish
that. Okay.
I'm ready.
This is a thing that I'm very passionate about, and I love it so much. And you don't like it because it's butter.
Oh. Oh my God! I love you so much. Oh my God! You're so cute. Oh my God, I love it. Oh, it's so fun. Okay. Tell me about butter.
Okay, I'm gonna tell you about
God.
Butter.
Okay.
Since I went to high school, I haven't done this much research.
I love it. I'm living for
ever.
It. That's so cool. Okay.
I love butter.
Ollie
is it
butter.
Unhealthy? Who knows? Scientists have yet to figure out if butter, consuming too much butter, is unhealthy. I'm fine. My physical health is you
fine.
Know, whatever.
Butter is, yes.
That's going to the history of butter.
Oh my God, I'm so excited. Okay.
Okay. So the earliest forms of butter that people think that now that were made was most likely made from sheep or goat's milk, because cattle wasn't domesticated for like 1,000 years.
Oh.
Like after we domesticated sheep and goats, so we had them for a long time before we domesticated cattle.
Why didn't we? We're sacred.
Big animals.
Oh,
scary big
might hurt us. Okay, makes sense.
Scary big might hurt.
Yeah.
Can't give us fur.
True.
Really, like
true.
So.
They just have one purpose.
And
yeah.
Also, I guess, location of where we were hanging out at.
Yeah.
In the world.
Mm-hmm.
And to make butter in the olden days, like 2,000 years ago, or more than 2,000.
Probably,
God,
yeah.
Fucking 10,000 years
ago. Yeah.
People would pour milk into goat skins, and then they would seal that up like a bag, and they would put it on from a rope on a tripod, and then they would push it back and forth, like rock it until it became, so like for hours.
Until it
became butter.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And they used that for anything. They could use it to like, it was used for like medicinal value as well. Mm-hmm. Like cover up open wounds and stuff because of the fat.
Yeah. Okay.
And then the ancient Greek, butter was considered like the food for extremely poor people, extremely poor people, and like barbarians ate butter. It was made for them because it was like the lowest form of food.
Interesting.
There is even like a comedic poet called Alexandrius, who referred to people from the Balkan, which was like the barbarians, as the butter eaters in his like poems and prose. And both Pliny and Galen, who are two of the like ancient Greek / Roman Empire, like the biggest philosophers, they stated that butter was only to be used for like medicinal things.
Not for eating.
It was not for consumption.
Was it because like goats were considered to be like lows?
No, by then they had like cattle. So like, I don't know. It was just like the lowest form of like food.
Crazy.
But their gods ate like ambrosia. So
yeah, that's true.
So like,
yeah.
And then in the Middle Ages, people in Europe started to find methods to store butter longer because of the colder climate here. And they would like bury it in the ground.
Like a cellar?
Kind of, but like just like bury it in the ground. Or in the Scandinavians were particularly good at this because of our weather. It's cold as fuck up here.
Yeah.
And they would store butter in like... the wetlands kind of of Sweden, so like in a what's a shed?
Oh god.
Okay, so anyway, like in these like wetlands, they would store them under the water for like years, like for a long time, because then it wouldn't spoil.
That's cool.
Yeah. And Scandinavians were also the first to make enough so that they could export it and trade butter. So we were first with that. Even though if it was still like a poor man's food, like only peasants would eat this.
Yeah.
And then in the early 16th century, butter became more popular in the middle and upper class because the Roman Catholic Church allowed it to be consumed during Lent, which is the fast before Easter.
Yeah.
And so then it became more like a thing that people would be like, well, we can at least eat butter and bread or butter on a spoon.
Yeah, like you do.
Like I do. And after that, bread and butter became a common like middle class, in the middle class, particularly in England. And then the English also started to use it to cook like meat as the sauce or on vegetables because it added so much flavor. Well, you don't have to like. I know you hate butter.
Am I boring you?
Am I boring you with my butter story?
You really know the thing is
butter facts. Ireland and France had the largest consumptions of butter in the Middle Ages, and like up to like modern days, almost like before the US. But like Napoleon III in 1860 had to offer like prize money for whoever could like come up with a substitute for butter because there was such a big lack of it.
Oh my god.
Hence margarine.
Oh really?
Yeah.
That's the story.
Was invented in 1869 by a French guy.
Oh my god.
Yeah. So that's why margarine is a thing. And he got the prize money for that by Napoleon III.
Cool.
The USA was the first to build butter factories in the early 1860s. And until then, butter had been made like by hand on farms, like churned by hand.
Yeah.
All across the world to be like traded. It was still like a trading good. But it was just like handmade of it. So the US of A was the first one to build factory. Industrialize it.
It's gotta be lazy in some way.
Yeah, of course.
Manual labor is just not for the for the US.
Let's get all the machines. And then a Swedish inventor in the late 1870s, he was called Carl Gustav Patrick de Laval. He introduced the centrifugal cream separator, which made the process much faster, because before you had like by hand separated the, when you milk a cow or whatever, it comes like milk and then there's cream on top. And then you had to separate it, but he made a centrifuge that like separated it, and a machine, and that made everything sped up the like
process
so like dramatically that it became like they could really like sell butter a lot. So that was the it was first only used in factories, like in big factories, but today it's the separation process mostly takes place on the farms. And before, you had to send all of the milk to the factories and then it got separated there, and then it got sent back to like feed milk and stuff. But now it's separated at the farms, like as they're doing it, and then it gets sent away separately.
That's cool.
The country that consumes most butter in the world is?
The US.
No.
Is it not?
No.
Is it Sweden?
No.
It's...
Okay. You're not gonna guess this ever.
Am I not? India.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Yes.
It's India. They have a lot of buttery food.
That's true. And also a lot of people, so that makes sense.
A lot of people.
Yeah.
A lot of people.
Yeah.
Closely followed by the US and France.
Oh,
and me,
and you, and then you, and you, then you I'm kick Sweden up there. You put us up there.
Definitely. So I'm gonna talk. My second to last thing is I'm gonna talk a little bit about different varieties of butter.
Okay.
From this different places in the world. I'm not gonna pronounce on any of these right. So
no one's expecting you to. you're good.
Bear with me.
Yeah.
Butter with me. The first one is smen, and it's a spiced Moroccan clarified butter, and that's really like common there to use on food, and like it's very spicy, and then we have maltish, which is from the Hansa Valley in Pakistan. It's combined cow's and yak's milk, and it's buried in the ground for decades.
Oh, wow, really?
And it's only used at, like, special occasions, like weddings and funerals.
Oh, wow.
So, like, it gets very, like, spicy.
Yeah.
And, like, sour. So, that's one type. Then, yak butter is very common in Tibet because they have more yaks than, like, that's their cow.
Yeah.
And then I have one that's close to home. In Poland... there's a tradition for like in Catholic homes to like in the Easter meals to have a little lamb made of butter.
Oh,
and it's either handmade, so you sculpt it out of butter, or you
out of
make
like
it
frozen
in,
butter.
No,
or?
Like just cold butter. You have to work fast as fuck.
Yeah.
Or you put it into a mold.
A mold, yeah.
And we had this like in my dad's family is. Catholic Polish Catholics, and we had this on our table.
That's
at
so
Easter.
Cool.
It was like a little lamb of butter, and you just eat it. And and now I'm gonna tell my favorite story about butter.
Is it the hospital
You're in
story?
It.
It's the hospital
You're in
story.
It. Yeah. Once upon a time, not long ago, Eli was in the hospital. And this was before Corona, so I could go visit her in the hospital. And it was like at night, I went after work.
Yeah.
So it was like at night. And we like sat on your hospital bed.
Yeah.
And then a nurse came in with like the night tea and sandwiches. And Eli can't eat butter because your body hates you.
Mm-hmm.
And you did something in another life.
I feel like
that
I did.
Made your body eat fat.
I had karma. I have bad karma.
I don't know what you
something.
Did. Probably like
something really bad.
Something really
I don't know
really,
if that
really
was Jack
bad.
The Ripper or something.
Yeah,
in
probably.
Life,
I mean, that's unlikely.
Right, I feel
yeah,
like it is.
Yeah.
It's probably
definitely. Mm-hmm. But like, and I've worked at the hospitals in our town. I worked there
in the kitchens.
Mm-hmm. And when I worked there, we used one type of butter that is disgusting. It's a spread butter for like sandwiches and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a lot of types of butter in Sweden, but it's unspeakable. I hate it. It's so disgusting.
Shouldn't be called butter.
It should be called trash because that's where it belongs. And it was butter on your sandwiches.
Yeah.
So
and I when that happens, I need to scrape it.
Yeah.
Scrape
so you
it
took
off.
A plastic spoon and scraped it off.
Mm-hmm.
And jokingly, you said, "Do you want this?" And I was like, "No, that's probably letta. That's what it's called." I only like if I'm gonna eat it on a spoon, it's gotta be brigott. And you were like, "I think they actually use that." And I was like, "No, I'm pretty sure they don't because when I worked there, we didn't." And then you gave me the spoon and I was like, oh, I'm gonna try it. And then I like licked the spoon a little bit and I was like, oh, it's brigott, which is the good one. And I just put it in my mouth and you went.
And I was like, okay.
Did you just put a spoonful
butter?
Of butter in your mouth? Like ice cream? And I did. Because I love butter.
And did not regret it for a second.
Did not regret it for a second because it was really tasty. And like whenever we like cook, I drench my food in butter.
When we eat baked potatoes, you eat butter with potatoes. Like
I
you.
Eat like, I eat, so the packages are like this big.
Yeah.
And I eat maybe a third of a package with one potato.
For sure. It's crazy.
I buy butter here.
Yeah.
Because you would.
There's so much butter going
and
on.
And it's so expensive.
That's
so,
crazy.
And I love like just so when I that's my biggest like sadness that you can't like eat all the buttery food that I want to make for you because I want to make so much buttery food for you, which is just like so good. Fat is so good. I love fat.
It is good. My taste bud says,
Your stomach,
my stomach says
let's die.
No, let's be sick for 2 days.
Yes.
Yeah.
I
so,
love
that.
Yeah.
So great. I love that you did research on butter.
For days.
Oh my
God. Do you remember like 4 days ago when I was like, I started research.
Mm-hmm.
This wasn't what that was.
Holy crap. That's amazing. I love that. Oh, it's so great. I would not have guessed that.
No.
Anytime,
no.
ever.
No.
I don't think.
No.
Oh.
Now I've burned my best one.
Yeah, a little bit.
I don't know.
What,
I'm not.
I'm still holding on to my best one.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, this one, I'm not passionate about anything else.
No.
I've talked about all of my things.
You're done now.
Yeah, I'm not. Like, you have a lot of passions.
I do.
I'm like, butter. And butter and attention. Thank you so much.
I'm done now. That was it.
But I don't get I don't get into stuff like you do.
No,
I
get obsessed.
I get obsessed over an afternoon and then I'm done.
Yeah.
And I don't do research on stuff even though I love them. Like, you know, like the names of band members.
Yeah.
I know Hayley Williams.
Yeah. Yeah. Always when I talk about McFly.
And only
and, like,
because she did a song with like Will I Am and people, and I was like, oh, who's this? Oh, the singer. Oh, I get it.
Yeah,
that's the only reason I know it. Like, I don't
no,
I just don't.
I deep dive and then I swim around there for months and then I completely drop it, but by then I know. Like, if I like a book, I'm like, I'm gonna read everything this author has ever written, and then I do.
If you like Johnny Depp, you're gonna watch every movie that he's ever done.
I did do that.
You did do that.
Or just like buy every album or yeah. That's very me.
I'm like, oh, this is me. That's my reaction to
then
everything.
You move on.
Then I move on.
Yeah, sometimes I'm like and you're like
I remember with like Hamilton.
Oh my God.
Karen and you. So Karen, our best friend. You were like,
it took you so long to listen to Hamilton.
Yeah.
so long.
And it took even longer until this, like, Dear Evan Hansen. Yeah, you talked about that for, like, a year.
Yeah.
And then I was like, then it came up on my Spotify, and I was like, oh, this song is
kind of already have a tattoo, I think.
Yeah. And I was like, have you heard this song? And you were like, this is what I've been talking about for 2 years.
Yeah, I had the tattoo and everything by the time you listened to Dear Evan
Hansen. When I first started listening to one song, and I was like, this is kind of cool.
I
have this ink on my body.
Exactly. I've had it for a year. Come on.
Oh, yeah. My goodness. Yeah. But we're going to figure out more stuff to talk about. I'm sure.
I have, like, weeks and weeks.
Yeah. There's no rush. We're not going to. That was awesome. I love that. Put it in an hour and a half. I think an hour and a half is a pretty good time.
Yeah.
For us to, because if we do two topics and we talk for like 20 minutes a topic, yeah, it's pretty decent.
Yeah, no, no.
Now I want to know what the song was.
Oh,
the songs I wrote, the played.
You wrote them? Oh my god!
I wish. The songs I played. The first one was called "Everything I Own." The second one was called "Baby, I'm a Want You."
Do you know what we can do?
Put it in the box down below for sure. The last one was called Diary. Yeah. We'll put them in the box down below, so you can see them. And the Bread. I'm going to say Bread. It's probably not. That's a really weird band name. But honestly, they had the Beatles at the same time. So
the Bugs. Like,
just substantive. No, nouns. It's the English version of that word. Nouns are just band names.
Yeah.
Should we... I was gonna say, should we try some comments, but there's a lot of them.
Yeah.
I was gonna swipe. Did you see that I was on my way to swipe?
Oh dear God.
Yeah, we haven't checked any comments at all. Just me singing.
Should we do this? Should we do the thing and then do that?
Yes. Okay, so 7 o'clock has passed.
So annoying to hang out with after this pandemic.
Oh yeah, definitely, because we just read each other's minds.
Yeah,
like, did you hear I was about to say read our minds?
Yes. Because we read our
minds. We read our mind because we have the same one.
I hate us.
I hate us.
Anyway,
7 o'clock has passed, and it is time.
It's a tradition.
If you were not on our last Chill Out Corner, our 7 o'clock tradition is to list the good things or positive things about the day. Yeah. It started as a little tradition about 2 months back.
Yeah, more than 2 months.
2 months back, when we were both going through a little bit of a stumble, and I decided we need to start
meditating
on the day, and it's a tradition that stuck, and we're continuing to do it. And I have a little alarm on my phone every day at 7 o'clock, and it's time. Do you want to start?
I can start,
because I think I started last time.
I have two things. My first thing is I got to go to the hairdresser.
Yay!
Finally, after saving for months and months and months.
Yay.
And it was so nice. And it's just so nice to have, like, someone touch your hair.
Yeah.
I love it so much. And she's just, I showed her like two pictures and she was like, I get it. And then I got exactly that, but 1,000 times better. And I love her so much. She's
love
amazing.
That.
And I'm so happy.
It's so great.
It looks awesome. It's so cute. And then my second thing is doing this, because I love this, and that's going to be my positive every time.
Yeah, this is
because it's so
a
nice.
Really great concept.
No, but
I
I think my third one is that we, like, I love that we don't tell each other what we're going to talk about, and it's so random and so much fun, and it's just...
It's a way to surprise each other,
yeah,
in a way, which is
so
really
much.
Great.
Because we tell each other all things every second of the day.
Yes, the minute it happens.
Yeah.
Like, I tell Ollie before I tell my parents.
I live tweet at you as things are happening.
Yes, very much, very much so.
So yeah, it's really nice.
It's really fun. I love that. My positives is that I also have a few, actually. It's been a good day. I got my Guitar Hero. And I'm so excited. I bought Guitar Hero.
You have to teach me, because I don't know.
If you want to, I would love to.
I would get so frustrated, and I might cry and have a panic attack. But
okay.
I will definitely, I
think you will like it when you get the hang of it. Because, like, I don't either.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll play.
You literally did so well on two songs.
It was
just
easy.
Then.
It was like the easiest mode.
Yeah. But
also, I used to play a lot, so it's in my veins. You should see the first song I played when I first turned it on. I was like,
that's gonna be me for like 3 months.
Yeah, it's fine. We'll figure it out.
So I got my Guitar Hero. I'm very excited about that. This was so fun.
I loved hearing you talk about butter. That was a lot of fun. That was really, really great. And I finally got to color my hair. Or I finally got you to color my hair, which feels great.
Nice. It looks good.
Because now it's one color, and I love that. It's awesome. And, it's been a good day.
Yeah.
It's been sunny.
A good day.
It's been sunny outside. It's cold, but it's sunny, which I love.
If I do this, it looks like I have an album here.
It does.
I look like Alvin, the chipmunk. No, but the one.
Yeah, that's
what
I was like, Alvin and the chipmunk.
So I haven't watched the movies for the Lord of the Rings.
Oh, but you mean the
arrow one.
I've only just seen them once. But I agree with you. I do think you.
I have slept through them a lot.
Related.
We shouldn't put this one.
We can cut before this is over.
Okay, let's go.
All right, let's go through some comments.
Yes.
Yes, you want to swipe, but you can't.
Our stupid brain.
Should we just start from the beginning?
From the beginning.
I don't know. Scan through it.
I think this is sort of what
sort of where we were.
Yeah.
Oh, this is when you talked about the law language.
Yeah.
Yes.
And there's a quiz you can take.
Oh.
If you want.
If I'm not sure.
If you're not sure. But I'm pretty sure about yours.
I feel kind of confident in both of ours. So it's good.
Oh, mine is
obvious.
There's no other way.
No, it's obvious. I missed the beginning of this. That's fine. You're going to see it on YouTube later if you want to.
Oh, this was the one about the sister
gifting.
And the
yes,
gift.
Yes, right.
Yeah, we got it. I have a friend who doesn't like hugs, and when she told me, I stopped greeting her with hugs because I figured that,
That's really good.
And
that's
like,
really good.
I think that should be, like, the first. I'm very, like, about this now. I'm like, do you want me to hug you? Because it's, like, a consent thing. And I think that should, like, be a thing for, like, all forms of touch.
Yeah.
Because some people don't like it, but they have been, like, conditioned to be, like, it's
a societal thing.
But if you're not, like, comfortable with touch, you shouldn't have to be touched.
I think also now, like, in Corona times, I think the reason, because we don't really hug in Corona times.
No.
And I think that's also like what
this is an exception
because we basically only see each other. So like that's definitely an exception. Plus I'm vaccinated now. So, I think that's why it doesn't like fall naturally to hug when you greet someone anymore.
No.
And I don't know when that will like start up again.
I will kiss everyone. Like, forget what I said. I will kiss everyone on the forehead and hug them for 45 minutes. Like the bus driver. the random person on the street, the person in the cashier, everyone, I will hug and kiss them.
Yeah,
because
give it all.
Yeah,
give all the love.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, more look more into it. It's very interesting with the love languages. It's really cool. Ollie, what makes you feel love? My brain cuddles. Yeah,
all the cuddles.
It's the best.
Siri pronounces it like bread. Well, it's because it's spelled like bread. But my dad said breed, and at this point,
what? Oh, your dad.
My dad. Did I say dead?
Yeah.
He's not. My dad. My alive dad. My living dad.
You have to call him revive now.
My living dad said
breed. We don't have time for that.
To call him now and say, Dad, how do you pronounce it? But I'm pretty sure he said breed. And that could be because his English isn't great, but that could also be because he'd listened to them for like 30 years.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Oh, I've heard this. See, a lot of people have heard the first song.
It's really good.
I think it's been in a commercial or something, the first one that I played. I think it might have been.
Probably.
I listen to the playlist on Spotify with songs with key changes in it. Oh, yay!
So good.
I love that you listen to it. That's awesome.
It's so good.
It's really, really great. Heard this before. Oh, yay! That's so great.
Yay, the bass.
Thank you for all the applause.
Good. A little good one. A little good one. Yeah.
Ollie is hyping it up. Yes. The butter.
Everything in butter. No. Glass was transported in butter.
Oh! And if everything arrived healed and not broken, everything was in butter. I love that.
Oh my god, that's cool. Amazing. Oh, I didn't know that. That's my new really, favorite really thing. Cool.
I really like this butter TikTok. Yes.
Welcome. You're welcome. I absolutely love listening to this secretly in my earbuds.
The yes. commitment to this.
Yes. No butter. I know. The world is cruel. You can't have regular, like, real cheese or butter.
Or butter or...
Donuts.
Donuts. Anything with, so like,
sad.
Oil.
It makes me so
or
sad.
Cream or...
Cake or pastries.
No, because it has butter in it. Anything that's, like, fat. Like, fatty.
More
I
than
can't.
10% fat.
More than 10%, yeah. In 100 grams, I can't.
What did you do in your past life? Like, did you murder people? Because I think that's the punishment.
And probably. Is that you can't eat fat in your next
yeah,
life?
I think yeah. so.
That's probably it.
I'm gonna really for when my metabolism stops working. And I just finally, like, can start gaining weight again.
Yeah.
And, like, the butter is just gonna, like... Fill me up
yeah.
a little bit. I'm so excited for that because
fill
God
up.
Knows I need it.
Buttercup, baby.
Yay. Yes. Butter research.
Yes, the butter research.
Wait, oh. No. Jesus.
I think
God
we,
Christ.
I think, no, I think we have
to.
All right.
Yeah. I'm doing mine today. I have two. I was my sister. What?
One was my sister protecting me when a creep was talking about me today.
Ooh.
Two was this life. Oh, yay!
Oh, that's so good.
This is such a good thing to do. I'm so happy meeting up and working with my study group and Will today. Oh, awesome!
So
I've been
nice.
So anxious about it, and now I'm so relieved. That's
yay!
Awesome! I'm so
a
happy
student.
For you.
Right.
Study groups are important as a
yeah,
nursing student.
Definitely.
I've been saying it over and over.
Yeah.
I worked on a small job and continued painting a picture. That's so fun!
That's so much fun!
Got out of bed early, was productive and prepared everything to go back to college tomorrow.
Oh my God.
Awesome.
That's amazing.
That's really great.
Yay. I got out with my students, one grader.
Aww.
That's so sweet. After being away for a week and a half, there was so much cute telling me how much it means. Oh my God.
That's
so amazing. I love that.
Hey, that's my niece. My niece is here. Hey, Julia.
Hello.
Hi. Hello,
baby.
I think I know the band you're talking about. The name is really bread, as in the food. They come up with a name when they were stuck in traffic behind a bread delivery truck. That does not surprise me in the slightest. I
love the
you.
60s and 70s.
Everything
it's
so
was
great.
Just
it was like, what about? Oh, look, there's a beetle. Hey, do you want to be the Beatles? Do you want to be the Bugs?
Do you want to be the Bugs?
What if we specify? Like a specific bug.
Like a ladybug.
Like a spider.
Spider. Spider.
Little cocky. Little
the spiders in the jello submarine.
Oh, maybe it's how about the beetles?
Yeah, man.
Right?
Yeah.
I wanna be bread. I love that. I've been training my cats to brush their teeth for a week, and today they let me do it. Oh, that's so great. I love that.
I want 12 kitty cats.
Oh, yeah. Ollie keeps sending me cute videos and gifs
so that
and
you'll
pictures
get a cat.
So that
I
I'll
can
get a cat
the
that Ollie can borrow. Yeah. It's
smart
close.
Like they.
It's close. It's getting close.
Yeah.
Hasn't happened yet, but I have game night with some friends at 1 a.m.
That's
really
so
great.
Nice.
I love that.
That's awesome.
Game night's so fun.
It's so great. I miss having game nights.
Yeah.
I had a meeting with my bachelor thesis supervisor, and it went really well. Yay!
Ooh.
That's awesome. I remember doing that. That was really scary.
Never. No.
I'm glad it went well. Really glad it went well.
I want a cat.
You can have a dog. I have two.
No, I want a cat.
Not good enough.
I have dogs already.
The dogs are not.
Yeah, they're right here. They're sleeping very, very nicely.
They're very tired. Look at the little dog. Look at the little doggles. Oh, cuddle buddy. Oh, hi, Happy. Oh, you're gonna. Wait, what are you? How are you?
You're gonna wake up.
Vibing.
Oh. What are you? Are you okay?
Oh, we're snuggle buddies now.
Ooh. I didn't hurt you.
He just
touched you.
Maybe you're lying on his legs or something.
There we go. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry I made you feel that way.
You can borrow my cat broomstick.
Yes, please.
That's a cute name. I just want to say I love this format of a live. Feels like I've been hanging out with my friends all night. Yay, I love that.
I love that.
That's really great. We love that you guys love this as much as we do. Today, my special someone got a go for our first holiday get together.
That's fun. You have no idea. I've like screamed about this.
Yeah, always screams about this all the time.
I'm sorry about your like. I told Eli the second you told me.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. But also.
Ollie's like, I couldn't. Do you know Laura?
And I was like, yeah,
yes,
I know Laura.
I know Laura.
I know who Laura is. Thank you.
Okay. If you want to hang out with me,
yeah. We're so happy for you.
Yay.
And the puppers are so happy for you.
They are the most.
Yeah, happy. There's your brother.
He's there.
He's there. We're gonna vibe down with the doggos here, just like chill out a little bit.
They have a cat named Dobby, just like CJ.
Oh, that's so cute. My colleague told me a few days ago that she's gonna get a golden retriever and she wants to name
a Dobby.
A golden retriever.
A cat named Dobby.
And she wants to name it Dobby.
I will steal it.
And I said, that's awesome. We're both gonna have dogs named after Harry Potter characters.
Yes. Oh, no. I when I babysat the puppers, I was on a walk and we met another dog and they became friends. They were the bestest of friends. He was so nice. He was like Hannibal. He was like
very chill.
Very chill.
Yeah.
So I was like, yeah, fine.
That's good.
And the lady, she was like, so what's their name? And I was like, should I come up with other names on the spot?
No.
But I was like, so this is Hannibal. And she was like, Hannibal for that little one? And I was like, yeah, you know, the murder eats people. And this is Remus. And she was like, oh, what's that? And I was like, it's from the Harry Potter book.
Yeah.
And she was like, the what now? And I was like, yeah.
That's what it is.
You're like, they're not mine. They're not. No, that was the thing. She was like, so where do you guys live? And I was like,
we live over there. We live over there. My little snuggle booty.
My little booty.
I think that's it.
I think that's it too.
That's it for today, I think.
It's booksy.
I don't know where he's going now.
Away.
Thank you for joining us for episode 2 of our little chill out corner. We're really happy you guys came and enjoyed and
snuggled up with
me. I miss you. Me so pretty, också, Julia.
Oh, pupsies.
Kul att du tittar förbi.
Ja.
Och hälsa hela familjen. Hälsa Tova. Hälsa mamma. Hälsa pappa. My little niece came by. Thank you guys for coming. We had a lot of fun. And we hope to see you next time.
Yeah.
Keep a lookout on our Instagram. Mm-hmm. We'll be posting when it's happening, probably in about a week or two, generally. That's how we do it.
Yeah.
And We'll see what we do then. If we do this again, or if we do something different, we'll see what we go up for.
Okay.
So, hope you have a great night.
Yay.
Or day, depending on where you are in the world. And we'll see you guys around.
Bye.
We did it.